Harper One and Harper Audio present Her Daily Bread. Inspired words and recipes to feast on all year long. By Kate Wood. Read by Sarah Zimmerman. For my children, may you come to rely on Him as your daily bread. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/her-daily-bread. The enhancement contains the recipes mentioned in this book. It will be referred to throughout as the enhancement. Introduction. Can I tell you a secret? Sometimes I get out of bed in the morning strictly for that first sip of coffee. I've long been a morning person, but motherhood has a way of making even the earliest of risers sneak out of bed before the sun comes up to capture a few minutes of solitude. When it's just me, the tea kettle, and a French press full of ground coffee beans, I can gently lure my mind and body to awaken, to ready themselves for the busy hours that are to come. For many years, I did little to prepare myself for the day at hand. After all, you'd be amazed at what a girl can do with concealer and a clean-ish pair of sweats. I was surviving, but not thriving. And it wasn't until after my second child was born that I realized I needed more than flavored coffee creamer and a fresh smear of deodorant to make it through the day successfully. I needed real connection with myself, with others, and with the Lord. I needed daily bread, a time spent feasting on the very presence of God Himself, even more than I needed a second or third sip of caffeine. My hunch is you do too. After a few years of dabbling in the kitchen, I found myself in a full-blown love affair with baking and began my food blog, Wood and Spoon, in hopes of becoming a cookbook author. Early on, I didn't anticipate the healing that would come with storytelling or the encouragement I'd receive from readers who identified with the words I was writing. Yet each week, I'd receive emails from women who appreciated my vulnerability and wanted to share experiences of their own with me. As they told me about their memories of meals from long ago and the ways they use my recipes to love the people in their corner of the world, it became evident to me that food is a uniting thing, connecting us to our past, our future, and all the people we bump into along the way. At the table, there's an invitation to serve, connect, and give deeply of ourselves. And as I slowly uncovered the wealth of love available to us simply through physical nourishment, I began to wonder how it was all tied to our spiritual nourishment as well. So began this book. Consider the coming months with this book an extended conversation with a friend. In these pages, I've included a year's worth of scripture passages, personal stories, and life lessons that I'm still wading through myself. I'm about 30-something years into my own narrative, and much of what I've learned in these recent chapters of my life as a woman, wife, mother, daughter, and friend is reflected in these pages. My prayer is that by reading about the joys, hardships, and experiences that have brought me this far in my story, you'll pause to reflect on your own. This is an invitation for us to bring our thoughts, questions, and desires to the table to share together. There are 365 entries in this book, 52 of which are recipes. Most of the entries are short devotionals about our relationship with God relative to themes like womanhood, motherhood, marriage, friendship, personal growth, and of course, food. Each week, there are 6 days of devotionals, and on the seventh, we'll pause for a recipe. A soup, a batch of muffins, or maybe even some crazy delicious ice cream sandwiches. That recipe day is like a Sabbath rest in the midst of a hectic schedule. And my hope is that you'll use it as an opportunity to connect with others in your own kitchen and participate in some much-needed rest. Many of the recipes you'll find in these pages are connected to some of my most beloved memories. They are dishes I've shared with women who have fed me in ways far deeper than bread alone ever could. Most of us stand on the shoulders of the people who came before us, and that's certainly true for me. These pages are a thank you to them, the ones who nurtured and nudged and gave so much of themselves for my benefit. When you read the recipes and words that follow, I hope you'll bring yourself along too, interjecting your own experiences to settle in next to mine. We all have a seat at God's table, and I think it delights him to no end when we pull up a chair to share in community around it. He's our daily bread, and I can assure you there's more than enough to go around. So let's dig in. January. Day 1. Fresh starts. For many of us, the new year is an opportunity for change. On January 1st, we survey the pages of our lives like a fresh spiral-bound notebook that is ours to fill, eagerly penciling in changes to be made and vows to do better. For most of my own life, I've used the new year as my opportunity to rewrite some of last year's book, too, editing pages and scribbling out plot lines that I didn't want included in future volumes. Although many of us love the idea of reinventing ourselves in pursuit of a better life, we need to remember that God doesn't wait until January 1st to do a new thing. In Christ, there is always hope, possibility, and promise awaiting everyone who welcomes him as the author of their life. Jesus wants to write a triumphant tale for your days on earth, one filled with adventure and growth and joy and potential. Instead of simply filling our journals or calendars with plans and resolutions of our own, we can press into the dreams, blessings, and experiences that he has for us too. As you start a fresh new year, are there areas of your heart you need to surrender to him today? Maybe parts of your own plan that need to be aligned with his? Rather than settling for an ordinary year, you have the opportunity to lean into the unimaginable story he is writing. January 1st is as good a time as any to begin walking in new life with him. So if you haven't already, start today. Read Isaiah chapter 43, verses 18 through 19. Day 2. Good luck. The first January that my husband Brett and I were married, my father-in-law brought us a traditional Southern meal to celebrate the new year. I was still new to my husband's hometown of Selma, Alabama, having lived most of my life in Orlando, Florida, and the elements of that meal were a first-time experience for me. There were slow-cooked black-eyed peas, wedges of skillet cornbread, and peppery collard greens that were braised with smoked pork for both flavor and good luck. As we shared the meal, I learned that those foods are traditional on January 1st, as Southerners everywhere fill their cast-iron skillets with foods that are said to bring prosperity and good fortune. Although we still often enjoy beans and greens on New Year's Day for fun, I remain comforted knowing that God isn't the type to leave anything to a matter of luck. As believers, we don't have to roll the dice, wish on stars, or hope for something favorable in our skillets, because we have been called to rest in the promises of a God who works all things for our good. See Romans chapter 8, verse 28. He's already offered grace that is sufficient for everything we'll face this year, and our primary job is to remain confident in it. See 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. Be encouraged. The odds are in your favor with Jesus. Spend some time in prayer today and ask him to reveal any areas where you can rest more fully in his provision. Commit the coming weeks and months to him and remain hopeful in the blessed assurance that belongs to children of God. Read Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 9. Day 3. Resolving for more. My greatest success with New Year's resolutions happened the year I decided to start exercising. For 3 weeks, I jogged, lunged, and even did push-ups at my bathroom sink, determined that this would be the year I finally decided to love my body. Unsurprisingly, before the month was up, I had burned out and quit, my motivation overcome by an onslaught of shame over my lack of persistence. Since then, I've spent a dozen or so Januaries making the unsteady leap toward the illusion of achievement, starving and straining and guilting myself into perfect misery. Have you been there? I want to look at resolutions differently. I'm all for goals, but I'd like to work toward them for the right reasons. Instead of thinner thighs, I want more self-confidence. Instead of less debt, I want more financial freedom. Instead of fewer stress-induced gray hairs, I want more of the stuff that brings me life. Deep relationships, laughter, and rest. January may be the perfect time to cut back, make changes, or switch gears, but let's examine our motivations for doing so. Are you searching for contentment in things that won't satisfy? Or are you digging deep in order to uncover the very best that God has for you? When in doubt, move toward Jesus. By aligning your ambitions with the Father's heart, you can take manageable steps toward a life that looks more like His. Contentment in Christ is never misplaced. So this year, instead of being motivated by your lack, move toward the God who offers more. Read Proverbs chapter 16, verses 1 through 3. Day 4. Planning on Jesus. There's nothing better than cracking open a brand new day planner with its crisp edges and fresh pages, a year full of opportunities just waiting for my pencil or pen. I'm that person who writes down every to-do I can think of, no matter how small or silly it may be, because I take so much satisfaction in scratching it off my list, another task fulfilled. The downside to a thorough schedule is that I often fail to make room for the unexpected, the incidentals in the margins of my life that necessitate attention. Instead, I find myself rushing from task to task, rarely looking up long enough to see what I've been missing along the way. As good as it feels to achieve and accomplish, I know that fulfillment happens when I'm present. In my rush to check off another box, am I missing the opportunity to read a book to my daughter, to answer a phone call from a friend, to pray or take a walk, or give my husband a hug just because? I'll be honest, most days it's more gratifying to see a page full of check marks than it is to be present. But that's not the story I want to write. I know God has more for me. Are there areas of your life where you need to cut back? Slow down, make room for things in the margins. Ask God to show you some places where you can create space for more of the things He has for you, like rest, joy, connection, and growth. Instead of filling your minutes with things that won't satisfy, create room for God to jot love and blessing in the corners of your life. It's all right to make your own plans, but today, leave space for His, too. Read Proverbs chapter 19, verse 2, and chapter 21, verse 5. Day 5. Learning from Experience. Many of the older women I rub shoulders with learned to cook by watching other people in the kitchen. They weren't reading or following recipes. Instead, learning happened by putting their hands into bowls of flour, by smelling the sugar caramelizing on the stove, and by watching chicken skins fry to a crispy golden brown. Sure, you could put those measurements and techniques into words, but these women didn't need them. They learned by experience. Jesus was all about experience, too. He wasn't looking for scholars with head knowledge or lofty answers. He was looking for friends. The Bible shows us time and time again that real transformation happened when ordinary people experienced His extraordinary love, and that same principle applies to us today. We can consume all there is to know about God, but that knowledge alone will never make us holy. Speaker and author Graham Cook said it best. God isn't doing anything academic in us. He's not reaching our head. He's teaching our heart to walk with him. I don't want to become someone who knows about God, but still hasn't.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.